Many, many times in my church, I often wish I could preach as well as she can sing. Hasn't worked out yet. So I don't know about everyone else, but I always need one more prayer before I start because, well, we all need it. All right, if we could. Dear Lord, I just want to thank you for the opportunity we have to hear your word. And I pray that we don't see or hear anyone but you lifted on high. So if you would please bless the reading of your word, be with us today, and help us get the message that you have for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so I want to start off this morning by asking a question. Where is heaven? And just to let you guys know, I don't abide silent congregations. Either volunteer or victim, it's the same to me. So usually when I ask a question, unless someone volunteers an answer, I'm going to pick one of you. So silent congregations never get anything done. Look at the congregations of old. It wasn't a stage or a stadium where the person giving the message was on top and everyone was below. No, the person giving the message was below and everyone else was on top. It says, come, let us reason together. So today, this is what I want to do. So I have a question again. Where is heaven? It's up there. Oh, okay. Well, how about more specific? There you go. The biblical definition of heaven is wherever God dwells. Because what can exist in God's presence? Only that is good, right? All right, so I'll give you a little hint on where we're going today. The song that was just sung is going to be a lot about it. So it says, again, I ask, where is heaven? The biblical definition, wherever God dwells. Where is one of the places God should dwell? In your home. Do you know we don't have to wait to have heaven? We can have heaven now. In fact, it says we are told from the pen of inspiration that the home should be made as the word implies. It should be a little bit of heaven on earth. A place where the affections are cultivated. Isn't that a wonderful word, cultivated? It's not just something where you flip on a light switch and there it is. It says there was two men who prayed for rain, two farmers. And they were fervently praying because their livelihoods were based on it. So they prayed for rain, but only one went out to till the field to get ready for it. Which one expected the blessing? The one that tilled the field. When you see the parable where they're casting the seed, and there's the four different types of ground, the rocky, the stony, the pathway, the birds come down, the tanglements, and one landed on fertile ground. Did it just happen to be fertile ground? No, someone had to till the field. Someone had to go before. All right, so it says, the affections are cultivated instead of being studiously repressed. Our happiness depends on this cultivation of love, sympathy, and true courtesy to one another. Wow, that sounds like a great place I'd like to spend some time, wasn't it? It says the sweetest type of heaven is a home where the Spirit of the Lord presides. If the will of God is fulfilled, the husband and wife will respect each other and cultivate love and confidence. And if the parents who are the example have that, how do you think the kids are going to be? Oh, that's an amazing thing. God works powerfully through strong Christian families. It says, but the enemy of souls does not want to see parents and their children living, supporting, respecting each other. He doesn't want to see that joy. Why? Because that's exactly something he gave up, isn't it? Says, Satan works to destroy healthy families and trap people in habitual sin. He especially targets children and young people, doesn't he? Look at this world. Is this world designed for you to succeed, or is it designed to trip you up? You know, look at, why is it I can go, you know, across the street and I can get a hamburger for a dollar, but I can't get a vegetable for one? Why is that? Why is everything that is supposedly good as far as tasting it so bad for me? I always want, if God didn't love calories, why did he make so many of them? This is questions I have. That's why Christian parents need to learn how to wage spiritual warfare on behalf of their children and make home heaven on earth. So what is spiritual warfare? Well, you know, we often see the movies. We know what actual warfare is, right? Oh, it's that glorious person who stands alone and rallies the truth. They try to glorify something that is, if anyone's ever witnessed it, horrible. But spiritual warfare. The enemy is constantly working to bring anxiety, frustration, compulsions, and fear into the home. And then sometimes, unfortunately, we invite him by what we bring into the home. When home life is miserable, kids grow up wounded and often rebellious. A family that is constantly feuding cannot minister to anyone else. So, wait a minute. By weakening the family, what else can he weaken? The society and the church. Because we can't minister to others when we cannot give light we don't first have ourselves, right? It says the Spirit of God will bring to the remembrance. Can he bring to remembrance something that isn't already there? So what do we got to do? We got to put it there. Okay, spiritual problems can manifest in our children's rebellion, depression, addictions, and a host of other sins. Our tendency to address the outward symptom is a problem. You know, we all want that magic pill, huh? You know, that takes away all the symptoms, but unfortunately doesn't do anything to address the actual cause. Right? Isn't that what pharmaceutical companies are making billions of dollars on? Treating the symptom. What has it been? For the last 10, 20 years, we've known the cure for cancer, but no one wants to do it because it requires a change in lifestyle. You know, and one of the big proofs was, I know, a horrible guy, but whatever. We're working on him. Bill Clinton. He left because he had cancer, and he came back because it was gone. And they asked him, what did you do? So I went to a plant-based diet. Yeah, it's an interview. You can look on it online. He told exactly what he did. And it's amazing. It sounded very much like a New Start program I know about. A family that is constantly feuding cannot minister and cannot serve the body of Christ. So if the devil can succeed in destroying the family, he can usually count on weakening the church as well. So spiritual problems, they manifest. They deal with symptoms and not the root. But these battles will not be won by common sense. If we could do it on our own, did we need a Savior? If we could do it on our own, did Christ need to die? No. Worldly solutions and harsh restrictions. Instead, we need to resist the devil's plan in the spiritual tools. All right, someone open up to 2 Corinthians 10, chapter 10, verses 3 through 4. And I hope everyone brought their swords today because, like I said, if there's no volunteers, they'll be victims. So 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3 and 4.
For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God, for pulling down strongholds.
Pulling down strongholds. This isn't something that, you know, the Battle of Jericho was won by pulling down of the stronghold. All right, it says, you know, we don't walk after flesh. It says our enemies are not flesh and blood, but are what? Principalities, you know, in high places. So if you can see the person, that can't be your enemy. Do you know that? If you can see the person, it can't be them. It's what they've been taught, what they've been experienced. It's your opportunity to witness. Waging spiritual warfare includes living godly lives, discerning what is going on within our family. If you don't know what's going on in your children's lives, can you do anything about it? Makes sense, right? Okay. 1 + 1 will always equal 2. Won't be 3, won't be 4. So how you live as parents, extremely important to the spiritual success of our kids. Does that make sense? All right. We wonder why it says to the third and fourth generation. Well, okay, let's do a little, we'll do some genetics real quick. Father has dark hair, mother has dark hair. What's the chances of kids having dark hair? It's pretty darn good, right? Unless we have some very interesting, you know, I once got sent an email, which I thought was fascinating. Do you know the darkest skinned person and the lightest skinned person are both African American? You know, actually, not American, just African. It's amazing. One has absolutely no melanin anywhere on his body. It was amazing. You know, I love medical and genetics and things like that. So it's how that environment is will determine the child, right? But there's one thing on our behalf, and it's a powerful, powerful force. And who is that? God. Whenever you're doing, notice you have the advantage, because it's always 2-on-1. It's you and the Holy Spirit, you and the will of God, you and against whatever you're working on. That's why prayer is so powerful. That waging that spiritual warfare. But when mom and dad is living willful disobedience to the Lord, the children will suffer. No one can live a worldly life and expect to raise godly children. Well, what verse does that sound like? Something about a bad tree can never produce good fruit. And a good tree won't produce bad fruit. So going off of 1 Samuel 2, 22 through 36, and thank you that I'm glad it was so long it took three people to read it. I thought that was great. Eli has problems, doesn't he? You know, especially in the church. Some of the very same struggles Christian parents deal with today. Phinehas and Hophni, I'm terrible with these names, don't worry, were more than a handful, weren't they? Were they a little difficult? For Eli to control them, it was beyond what he was willing to do. Loving peace and ease, he did not exercise his authority to correct the evil habits and passions of his children. God says, I love you, therefore I chastise, therefore I correct. Therefore, I give you this wonderful tome of knowledge that is good for doctrine, reproof, okay, instruction in righteousness. Phinehas and Hophni had no respect for their father, the service of the sanctuary, and more than that, they did not fear God. Holding the highest office on earth, Eli did not hold his sons to their high calling. He allowed them to defile the offerings of God. And he never got after them for their... Did he know what was going on? Did he see? He most certainly did. But there's some great news as a parent. You are in a position to see the Lord move in behalf of your children. Okay, who's ever gone hiking in nature? I mean, way out there. Any hikers? I like hiking. I like going out where, you know, there is no trail. You know, not, you know, the road less traveled. There is no road, all right? But what is one of the things you always got to be wary about? The animals you're going to experience. I've been probably about this far away from a bear. It was kind of cool. It was going the other way. I made sure he kept going the other way. But I like going out there. But it's amazing to see the Lord moving on behalf of our children. So if you see a baby bear, what do? You stay away from it. Why? Because mama bear is around the corner. And if you are near her kids, what's going to happen? Now, we all know one thing even more terrifying than that. A human mama. She'll go after you and your family. No, okay. Don't get between mama and her children, right? This is common knowledge. Everyone knows this. But there's even a greater love, isn't there? And that's God's love for our children. You know, we can free them, him or her, from strongholds. Someone read for me 1 John 4:4. 1 John chapter 4, verse 4. I'm glad I'm hearing pages turn, because then I don't have to point at anybody. Yes.
The word of God
This means the Holy Spirit who is in us is greater than Satan and can lead us to spiritual victory. Notice what it says in the Bible. We got to remember, we got to pay attention to the small words. There are no extraneous words in the Bible. It says, resist the devil and he shall what? Flee. You don't flee from fluffy bunnies. All right? You don't flee from things that are a minor annoyance. What do you flee from? Things that are dangerous to you. Why does the devil flee? Why does the devil attack baby new Christians? Because he can't see the future. And he has no idea who you could be. Who you might be. Who you will be. Tell you a story. There was an evangelistic series, and they put so much money into it. I'm talking, they almost put $100,000 into an evangelistic series. And there was a big church. They had it. And the first day, everybody and their mama was there. All right? The entire congregation was there. They invited their neighbors, their friends. First day was packed. What do you think happened the next week? Few less. Some of the saints got a little tired, you know. What do you think that happened the next week? Less. How about the next week? It came down to the last day, and there was one person in the audience, and they were so discouraged. We spent all this money, we did all this time, and there's only one person in the audience. We failed. What they thought. In case anyone's ever read the story about him, anyone know who that one person was? A gentleman by the name of Mark Finley, who's probably one of our best evangelists, who has baptized thousands of people, who has gone into places where we were not allowed to go, but he was allowed in to preach. Do you think that was an unsuccessful evangelistic series? One person, but that one person baptized thousands. So, I got a question for you. Who here wants to limit the activity the enemy has in your child's life? Awesome. Who would here would like to know how? Guess where we can find the answer? In the Bible. It's an amazing thing. All right. So, there's a wonderful thing about inviting people to speak. Because there's some things an invited person can say to a congregation that someone who's here every day can't. Because that's the greatest thing about an evangelistic series. The evangelist can come in and just kick your butt, and you say, thank you. So, here it goes. First, clean up your own life. You can't give light you don't already have. Okay. I asked my congregation a question, and I got grumblings about it, but I'm going to ask it here too. Raise of hands. If God was coming tomorrow, who here would have things to change in their lives? Who here? Notice what that means. That means, are you currently ready? Ooh. Oh, that's uncomfortable. If we knew he was coming tomorrow, we had it. We knew definite. And there's things we need to change in our lives. Then when do we need to get started on those changes? Tomorrow? Next week? Yesterday? Can you share life that you don't first possess? Spend some time alone with God and confess all known sin. Come to a point of complete surrender. Who's ever, you know, there's tragedies in life, and some people have experienced it. Who's ever cried so much that they ran out of tears? That's what giving up, that's full surrender. When you give to the Lord everything that you have, everything that's left, there's nothing in the tank, it's all gone. Complete surrender. If you try to fight a spiritual battle while having outright rebellion against God, even in the private areas of your life, you will fail. Step 2, identify the root problem. We're always worried about the symptom. Forget the symptom. Go for the root. Can you? It says the symptom may be your child's rebellion against authority, drug abuse, or some other addiction, but the root of the problem might be your child's bitterness because of parental neglect or another issue from the past. That's one of the things about who is forgiveness actually for? When you give forgiveness, who is it actually for? For yourself. When something bad happens to us, when someone hurts us, it freezes us if we do not forgive them in that point of time. Our life cannot progress because we keep going to that point in time. And that person may never have known they did anything to you. They're living their life. They're off doing whatever it is, but where are you? Stuck in that point of time. So that forgiveness isn't necessary for them. It could be for you. Third, find spiritual authority for confronting the problem, because it's not going to be done in hours. When Satan attacked Jesus, our Lord countered the enemy's lies with what? Scripture. It is written. We need to do the same. For example, in dealing with a bitter child, we need to use Hebrews chapter 12, verse 15, which says, "See to it that no one comes short of the grace of God, that no root of bitterness springs up, causing trouble, and by it may be defiled." We need to find out, we need to increase this relationship. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 15. Fourth, pray in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. This means you ask the same thing He would in your place and then do it. It says, when we have the, not my will, but thy will be done. That means we have to find out what His will is, doesn't it? Praying in the name of Jesus puts the emphasis on His supernatural power and the authority He has delegated to His followers. He says, all power has been given to me in heaven and the earth. And what did He do with all that power? He gave it to you. He gave it to you. He says, you can call down all the hosts of heaven. You can say to that mountain, depart. If you want a reference for that, it's John 14, verse 13 through 14. Fifth, pray to your heavenly Father rather than talking to Satan. Keep your mind that you have no power on your own to bind Satan, but are simply declaring what has already happened in the spirit realm through the cross. Look at the back of your Bible. You already know how the story is going to end, right? We already have the victory. We can already claim the promises. You know, it was said earlier that Jesus would have come if there was only one person that believed. Well, in a way, I disagree. I believed He would come even if no one followed. Why? Because He said He would. It wasn't about us. It's not about us. He gave His word. He wrote a check, and that's a check that will never bounce. Even if no one follows, He would have still died for His creation. That's love. That's an amazing depth of love. Understand what God is going, what God has to do. Anyone in the medical field? I've got a friend. He's an ER doc. And more recently than later, he's come to a true understanding of the love of God, because he's seen some things none of us want to see. You know, he sees the father in the corner saying, "Why? Why did I let my son drive?" While his son is on the table fighting for his life. But he let his son drive instead of him. as he was thrown free from the car, the son was not. He hears from the corner, why? Why? Why does my child have to go through this chemo? Why couldn't I have gotten the cancer? And finally, he hears words that he hears quite often. Is there any hope? One was brought in, 17-month-old child. Couldn't keep anything down. Was having trouble respirating because there's fluid in the lungs. And they fought and they fought and they fought trying to bring breathing back, sinus rhythm. They tried and they tried and tried. And 10 minutes went past and 20 minutes went past and 30 minutes went past. And the door opened and the father walked in and he asked the same question so many parents ask. Is there any hope? Now my friend could have said, yes, you know, I saw a beat happen. I saw a quick little single gasp for breath. You know, I saw a movement. But he didn't. And so he had to tell that parent, no, there is no hope. Even if I would restore the heartbeat, restore the breathing, the mind is gone. Now, this is one of the questions I bring up to a lot of people when it comes to the idea of God, about the love of God. Because if we as sinful parents can't do something, what makes us think God could? No matter what that person, that child has done, do we love that child any less? No matter how far they've gone the wrong way, do we love that child any less? So what does make think God does? Except that God has to do something we will never have to bear. As he asks himself, why? Why did this have to happen? I did everything I could. What if that ER doctor turned around to the parents and said, okay, there's nothing left. Can you go pull the plug? Do you think they could have done it? But God will. God has to. His love is greater. And yet he's going to have to. He will remember forever all those who are lost. While we are in heaven, it says, all remembrance of those things have gone away. Every tear is dried. Will they still be forgotten? Who remembers? God remembers. That's why he gives us so much ammo. He gives us so much. That's why he wants the home to be like heaven. He wants to, before the tree goes up and find out it's a bad tree, he wants it cultivated as a seedling. He wants it brought up in his word. Is he going to deny you anything that is for your benefit? No. Does he want you to hold on anything that is to your detriment? No. One of the last things we can do. It says, if you pray for a while and nothing changes, get some godly friends to help you. Is there something about corporate prayer? Coming together and praying. Who's seen miracles in their own life? We've often think these miracles have to be some grandiose thing. Sometimes it can be very simple. Pray again in agreement with those friends that God would cause Satan to release your child from the stronghold and restore him or her to oneness with the family. Even gathering with one or two other friends greatly increases the ultimate success of your prayer. It says in his word, where two or three are gathered, there am I in the midst. You know, you ask some people, why do they come to church? You'll get a million different answers. But you know, that's the actual reason. Who here can be two or three on their own? No one? Believe it or not, I used to be very fat. I thought I could be. But no, even on my own, I could not be two or three. It says, where two or three are gathered, there I am. We come not to for the music, not for the word, believe it or not. We can read the word at home. We come because together, God promises he'll be there. We're actually spending time in the presence of our Heavenly Father. It's an amazing thing. You know, all these things he gives us, all these promises. Anyone ever seen that? It's a book called The Book of Promises. It lists all the promises in the Bible. Ever notice that every year it gets bigger? I got a question. Did the Bible get bigger? No. What are we doing? We're discovering more. Like it was said this morning, you know, as we read a passage in the Bible, and then a few years later we go back and read the passage again, doesn't it mean something different? Isn't there a depth to it? Wait, did the words on the page change? Did they rearrange themselves? Then what changed? We did. Our experiences, our interpretation, our life. Can anyone without kids understand what it's like to have kids? Oh, what's the difference between empathy and apathy? I don't know and I don't care. Okay, what's the difference between sympathy and empathy? No? Okay. Sympathy is I feel you're going through something, but I have no idea what you're actually going through. I feel bad that you're going through this, but I have never gone through it myself, so therefore I don't know what you're going through, but I feel that you're going through something. Empathy is, I know exactly what you're going through. Why? Because I've been through it too. Got a slight little story for you. Just to let you know, I'm a man of a million stories. So sometimes my wife will throw things at me or give me a signal like, okay. So I keep looking for it. Yeah, she's giving to me now. I helped start the prison ministry at Sac Central. And it was really neat because the guy I did it, he's my brother from another mother. We are very similar so much it's kind of scary. But we went to one of the jails and we started going there and preaching and sharing the word and doing Bible studies. And they would open up to him far greater than they would ever open up to me because he used to be a resident of that jail and they knew him. They see the changes in his life. He knows everything they're going through. He knew that he gained like 50 pounds because all he was eating was ramen noodle. I mean, when he had money on the books, man, everybody was his friend. Once that money was gone, where were they? I mean, you would have guys there whose biceps are bigger than my head, and I've got a big head. All right, they would be huge, and they're leaving crying. I mean, like ugly cry, like that blubbery, because someone is actually taking the time who was once there and shows them a way of escape. Isn't that what God does for all of us? He was tempted in a way we could never even fathom. We could never even touch. But he shows us a way of escape. Okay, so I've got this cool little part. And I was going to read it, but man, I'm long-winded. So it's the steps. It's the notes that I did to build this sermon. And in fact, because my 3 pages left, it's an outline based on every verse and everything needed from the Word of God, not just in order, between, let's see, this one is the family's divine origin, the relationship between husband and wife. Do you know that's found in the sanctuary? Do you know that's what makes us different than any other group out there? There were Seventh-day Baptists long before there were Seventh-day Adventists. So the Sabbath, no, that's not unique to us. The what makes us unique out of everyone is the sanctuary message. I mean, the divine U-turn. Okay, I'm going to go just a little bit longer and then I'll be done. Who's ever heard of the divine U-turn? It's in the sanctuary. Oh, it's like the basis of the sanctuary. Wow, I wish I had a whiteboard all of a sudden. Okay, so visualize. You have the outer court, right? You have all of Israel basically around it. And then you have the inner court. And to get to the inner court from the outer court, you have to go through the gate. All right. So the first thing you get through on the gate is the altar of sacrifice. All right. Just behind the altar of sacrifice is the laver. Okay. All right. And then you get to the other building. And you to get into that building, you have to go through the gate, door. Thank you. Good job. Yes. Every once in a while. Very proud. All right. All right. And as you walk in to the right, you see the table of showbread. Directly in front of you is the altar of incense. To your left is the seven-branch candlestick. And then you see a veil. All right. And on the other side of the veil is the most holy place where you have the Ark of the Covenant. Sitting on the top of the Ark of the Covenant is the mercy seat. On top of the mercy seat is the? Between the cherubim and on top of the mercy seat, you have the? Shekinah glory, the presence of God. Okay, so when Jesus, before he came to earth, where was he? Most holy place. He was in heaven. All right, so he was sitting on the throne. He was there. And then he was born on earth. All right, where he was born of the, what does the seven-branch candlestick represent? The light, the Holy Spirit. He was born of the Holy Spirit. He was the bread of life. He was a man of prayer. The incense is the prayers of the saints which went over the veil into the most holy place. Do you see his life in that section, in the holy place? He was the bread of life. He was born of the Holy Spirit. He was a man of prayer. Then he came down and he was raised up. He was raised from a child to adulthood. And then he went out and he was, what does the laver represent? Baptism. So he came out and he was baptized. And then he was, what's the next thing? Right when you go in? Sacrificed. So that he could open the, so that we could accept his sacrifice and be baptized and learn as he learned so we can end up in the, do you see the U-turn? He came all the way down to grab our hands and go all the, bring us all the way back up. That's the sanctuary message. It's all right there. In fact, when you look at it, you have the Ark of the Covenant going down to the holy place, going down the laver, going down to the altar of sacrifice in the entrance, and then you have from the side the Holy Spirit and the table of showbread. What did that just make? What's at the center of it? Jesus. You see that in the Ten Commandments. The first four commandments deal with what? Our relationship with God. So it is a vertical relationship. Well, the last six deal with our relationship with each other. What did that just make? What was found at the center? Jesus, the example. Okay, so if you guys want, I have that all. And it's something that you should take home and study with the kids. Study with the family, the husband, the wife, all that things. Because God truly wants heaven to already be here. We were talking about the Lord's Prayer. The thing is, people so often mess up the Lord's Prayer because they believe it says one word that it does not. It says, "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done." It does not say on earth. It says in earth. Do you live on earth or do you live in earth? You live on earth. So what does it mean by in? I'll end with this. What was Adam made of? Dirt. The dust of the ground. What do we call that? Earth. He was made of earth. So this isn't an impersonal thing. It says, let thy will be done in earth, because that's what we're all made of, as it is in heaven. This isn't on earth where it's some ambiguous thing where, oh, he came and died for us. That's so impersonal. He came and died for me. That's personal. That's a relationship. It says he didn't let thy will be done in earth, in me, as it is in heaven. That's a personal relationship. And that's how you bring heaven to home. All right, let's close in prayer. Dear Lord, you have prepared a place for us. But Lord, in our homes, we can prepare a place for you. Lord, we can prepare a home that is heaven, where you and your Holy Spirit dwell. We know that we can be seen as Christian without ever opening our mouths by our actions. Lord, I pray that our homes are so saturated in you that they are our haven. They are our heaven, where we have that joyous relationship that we will enjoy 100 times stronger in heaven. Lord, and let that example so shine that our neighbors are moved, that our towns are moved, that our cities are moved, our countries, and eventually the world, so that one day we can see you coming in clouds of glory. And this truly will be heaven on earth. In Jesus' name we pray.